Nasscom has come down hard on a proposed U.S. bill which looks to protect and grow American jobs. The industry body says the bill is riddled with onerous conditions and places, and I quote, unprecedented obligations on both Indian companies and at their clients. Joining us to talk about the bill in specific that's gotten and the issues concerning around it is the Nasscom president, Mr. Chandrashekhar. Chandrashekhar, thank you so much indeed for joining us. Let me begin this conversation by asking you about what the concerns are and, you know, what kind of implications will this have, is this likely to have, if this gets passed on in the Indian IT sector?
See, first and foremost, the bill seeks to impose a condition on the company and the business that is hiring the Indian service provider. And conditions are such that the company that is hiring them needs to guarantee that they would not displace any worker during the entire period for which the visa worker is deployed with them. Also that if the provider of the services, that is the IT company which is providing the services, comes to know of any such displacement, they will have to notify the U.S. authorities and they will have to withdraw from the workplace, meaning thereby that they will have to, in effect, abrogate the contract. All of these are unprecedented conditions, which actually not only get into the innards of a commercial undertaking, but also which, in a sense, impinge on legally binding contracts. It is these concerns which have actually also made the U.S. Chamber of Commerce come out and say that these proposed changes constitute an unacceptable intrusion into the working of businesses in the U.S. The other point of concern from the Indian IT industry's perspective is that these conditions are applicable to visa-dependent companies. And again, the visa-dependent companies are being defined in such a way that it impacts only the Indian companies. Any company which previously had more than 15% of visa workers was regarded as visa-dependent. That definition is now being tweaked under this guideline, under the bill, sorry, to 20%. Which is basically aimed at keeping non-Indian companies, which are significant users of H-1B, outside the purview of this amendment and restricting the impact largely to Indian companies. So I think these are all significant concerns, but the bottom line is that these amendments do not serve the very basic purpose that they were supposed to serve, namely to protect job opportunities for American workers.
Sure.
On the contrary, since a large percentage of companies that use visas would not be covered through this amendment, it is certainly going to be ineffective.
Right.
As far as the stated purpose is concerned. So
right.
From every point of view, it does not make logical sense.
Sure. So just one, you know, slightly broader point, if I understand this right, you know, many Indian companies over the last couple of years have been steadily reducing their dependence on H-1B visas. Correct me if I'm wrong. There was a time that 50% of H-1Bs given out were given to Indian companies, were given to Indian nationals. We were given to understand that that's been continuously coming down. Now, you're also saying that you're also seeing that this bill says the extension to H-1B for those who are waiting for a green card will not happen. Could you sort of quantify or give us some color on the number of workers who would be in this category?
No, I think there are several different issues which are getting mixed up in this question.
Right.
First and foremost, if you take the number of visas, 70% of H-1B visas, roughly 70%, go to Indian nationals. This covers both Indian IT companies and non-Indian IT companies, American or other country IT companies, which serve the U.S. market. And it also covers non-IT workers, doctors and other professionals, for example. So while the number of visas, the percentage of H-1B visas, 70% of it goes to Indian nationals, the percentage that is used by Indian IT companies is only 15%, which is less than 10,000 actually. And the number of visas used by Indian IT companies, not companies working out of India, but Indian IT companies, that has declined by more than 50% in the last 2 years. So there's what you said is absolutely right, that companies have been bringing down the usage of the visas. The other aspect is about the fate of people who have applied for green cards. And that's a separate action that's not coming through the legislation, but it is apparently, from reports that we have, being contemplated as an administrative action, because the authorities do have the right and the power to adjudicate on applications for extension of the H-1B visa. And typically H-1B visa is issued for 3 years and extended for another 3 years, so it could go on for about 6 years. But when a H-1B worker applies for a green card, and when that application is accepted, then the extension of the H-1B visa has been more or less automatic so far. What the contemplated action seems to be suggesting is that the authorities could exercise their discretion and not grant extension, which means that even though the person has applied for a green card, and even though that application is under consideration, once the extension of the H-1B visa is not given, the person loses the visa status and would therefore have to leave the country.
Right.
It doesn't mean that it will happen in all the cases. Even this provision has not actually been put into action at the moment. But these are apprehensions, and there is no doubt that these are significant apprehensions.
Mr. Chandrashekhar, we'll leave it there. Thank you so much indeed for putting this in perspective. Not good news. This is at a proposal stage yet, but at this point in time, it doesn't look good for Indian companies and the Indian IT industry in particular. That's the NASSCOM report for you.